our audience, and it is wonderful to be back in person for our public performance series. We have an expanded calendar of upcoming events from the Marie Rader Presenting Series, the Department of Music, and the Department of Theater and Dance. And you can browse those by visiting go.rowan.edu/tickets. If you have any questions, need any assistance, or would like to share feedback about your experience with us, please email performingarts@rowan.edu. Thank you and enjoy the program.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you all very much for joining us. This is the Rowan University Symphonic Band, one of our three concert bands here at Rowan, playing our first concert of the year. The group you'll hear after this, the concert band, is our ensemble mostly for non-music majors. This group has a lot of music majors in it, and then some from all concentrations on campus, all walks of life. The first piece that you just heard, Bach Fanfares by Jess Turner. The next piece, we're going a little off script. There's a misprint or two in the program order. We're only playing each piece once, and we're going in a different order. So the first piece you heard was Bach Fanfares. This next piece is going to be Life Painting by Aaron Curry, and I'll read you what he writes about the inspiration for the piece. Life Painting began with a walk through Centennial Park in Nashville, Tennessee, on a pleasant April morning. After a long winter in Minnesota, the many blooming trees and flowers were welcome. I soon noticed a variety of people, both young and old, stationed around a pond. As I got closer, I realized they were all painting. The idea of so many people interested in creating art was inspiring, and in turn, I was reminded of the sheer joy composing music brings to me. Life Painting was written to help encourage others to never stop adding beauty to this world. And I'll add that this piece is an adaptable instrumentation work, so most of the pieces we play, there's a part for every single instrument. And an adaptable instrumentation piece, like this, might be written in four or five parts, and then you have a lot of options as the conductor and students to determine which part you're gonna play to make it work for your ensemble. This is something that's been around for a while called flex band music, but at the start of COVID, the quarantine, it became a big project. A lot of composers started writing adaptable instrumentation pieces and adapting some of their existing works to be adaptable instrumentation. It was allowing a lot of school ensembles to play music when they had a bunch of random absences. Absences affect how successful a band rehearsal could go more than they affect like a math class because everyone's contributing. So this has been a welcomed addition to our educational repertoire and our repertoire artistically in general. And I think of all the adaptable instrumentation pieces that we've interacted with, this is definitely one of the most beautiful and my favorites. So I hope you enjoy Life Painting.
Thank you.
I should tell you what we're playing now, since it's kind of a mystery. This is Carnival of the Animals by Saint-Saëns. This piece was originally written in 14, I think, movements, so lots of animals. We'll just be hearing from four this evening. It was written originally, it's a parlor piece, two pianos and small chamber ensemble. It's now popularly performed in a few different versions, including that for full symphony orchestra, which is how many of us first heard the music. Saint-Saëns, during his lifetime, did not want this, he refused to allow this to be available in his catalog, did not want it played in public beyond those first few private performances. He thought it would delegitimize a lot of the concert music that was being performed by orchestras of his. But I don't know what he would think of it now, but it's by far his most played piece and most popular work, and one of the reasons that he's known by so many is this Carnival of the Animals. This arrangement for band is, again, one of many, many versions, but it's so beautiful and melodic, full of character. It works for really any instrumentation, and this excellent arrangement, we're excited to play for you now. And the elephant movement features our resident elephant, Matthew McKelvey on tuba. Hope you enjoy. Thank you. Six pieces by Frank Tekeli, Cajun Folk Songs. There's a Cajun Folk Songs 2 also two movements, and both of them are extremely popular and very, very commonly played by bands all over the country, probably all over the world, and have been since the early 90s when these works came out. He dedicates this piece to descendants of the Acadians, Cajuns, a group of early French colonists who began settling in Acadia around 1604. So he's tracing these songs back to Nova Scotia and then down Mississippi into Louisiana, and picked songs that have traditions kind of throughout this American Acadian history. The first is La Belle et le Capitaine, and the second, Belle. The first tells the story of a young girl who feigns death to avoid being seduced by a captain. It's a very free melody and really beautiful. The second, Belle, is about a man who goes away to Texas only to receive word of his sweetheart's illness, forcing him to return to Louisiana. Finding her unconscious upon his return, he pawns his horse to try to save her to no avail. It's got a folk melody that's much more textured and varied and rhythmic, and there's some, I will say, colors in the percussion section that have inspired many similar types of scoring in band music. This is a piece that I first played probably in middle school, and it's always a joy to return to it. I hope you enjoy both movements of Frank Tekeli's Cajun Folk Songs.
Thank you.
Our last piece is Byzantine Dances, which I won't even say anything about, we'll just let you enjoy. But the concert band is on right after this, so please stay tuned. There'll be a short, just 5 to 10 minute intermission while I make the change between groups. Thank you very much again for being here with us. Parents, thank you very much for your continued and always their support. This ensemble has come a long way in this semester, as they always do by the first concert, but also come a long way over the past 2 years. Like, this is our first real, the energy and the air and their musicianship, their ability to play with one another. This is the first time it's felt pre-COVID artistic and kind of a two-way communication, or a 40-way communication, as they're able to listen and play. So it's been really gratifying. I hope you've enjoyed hearing us play, because we've really, really enjoyed playing. And we really enjoyed rehearsing, and can't wait to get started on new music next week. Also next week is the first concert of the Rowan University Wind Ensemble. It's part of a woodwind festival that we have going on next week, so I encourage you to check out all the concerts coming up in the orchestra and chamber recitals and faculty recitals. But the Wind Ensemble on Thursday night in particular, there are a few world premieres. We'll be featuring our saxophone professor, Dr. Evan, Professor Feingold, our bassoon professor, our concerto competition winning senior, Tim Sadakasas, and just a whole bunch of other stuff. It's gonna be really special and memorable. So if you're free next Thursday night at 7:30, I hope to see you again. Thank you very much. This is Byzantine Dances. Thank you.
Natalie Paletta. I'm from Pensville, New Jersey, and my major is business management with a minor in economics and a concentration in honor studies. I've been playing clarinet in the concert band since spring of 2019. We open our portion of the concert with a brief but innovative selection entitled Focal Point by Brian Bomages. According to the composer, the inspiration for Focal Point was born out of a conversation with the students in the Madison West High School Honor Band. While they introduced a myriad of interesting ideas, they kept coming back to the ideas surrounding their experiences during the COVID pandemic. The consensus was that everyone felt extremely scattered and out of focus when everything went virtual for the first time. Then, as routines began to settle in and they adjusted to their new temporary normal, things began coming back into focus for them. Thus, the idea of starting out of focus and moving into clarity became the focal point for this work. Enjoy as the Rowan University Concert Band opens our portion of the concert with Focal Point.
Freshman here at Rowan University. I'm majoring in music education, and I've been in the band since last semester. I just want to give you a quick little insight to our next piece. With genius and grace, African-American slaves transformed bitter human experience into a beautiful art form called the spiritual. One of the most haunting African-American spirituals, made popular in the 1870s, is Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child. Tonight, the Rowan University Concert Band honors Black History Month with Fantasia for Motherless Child, written by Stephen Bullough for alto saxophone solo and band. A soloist tonight is Lawrence Dielman. Larry is an alumni of Clearview and is a 3-year concert band member majoring in sports journalism. We hope you enjoy as the Rowan Concert Band honors the tenets of Black History Month with Fantasia for Motherless Child. Thank you.
Thank you. hope you didn't blink too many times because you would miss that first piece through there. My name is Mark Kadetsky, and I'm the director of the concert band here. And a couple remarks about this band. First of all, we have the students up here speaking because we're trying to teach our younger students some of the old-fashioned communication skills and some of the old ways, like things like dial tones and talking and not texting and things like that. And they certainly rise to the occasion. We're very proud of them today. Wanted to get up and speak to you about what they were doing tonight. And the other really cool thing about this band is, as Dr. Higgins said, it's largely comprised of non-music majors or music majors who want to pick up some experience on a second instrument, or they just are dying to hear my jokes every day, and they come out and they sign up for that. But something that I say at every concert, and I apologize if you've heard this 3, 4, 9 times, is that what I like most about this band is that these kids don't have to remain in band, but they choose to be lifelong learners and lifelong musicians. And that credit, the credit for that is binary. First, you as parents for instilling that belief and for signing that paper in fourth grade when they came home from instrument rental night and fulfilled their hopes and dreams. And that little piece of paper on instrument rental night has really transferred and transformed into what's behind me here. The second group of individuals and collective group is their elementary, middle school, and high school music teachers. So if you're enjoying seeing your children and your family and your friends up here, shoot a quick email to their elementary music teacher or their middle school band director that they perhaps tortured, or their high school band director, and let them know, like, say, hey, listen, you know, my kid is still playing. I just got back from his concert. It was great. And we make a great team, the parents and teachers. And feel free to CC me on that, kadetsky@rowan.edu, so I can help chime in. And you know, teachers can use all the support and motivation that they can right now. And especially if I was your child's elementary music teacher, there's a couple. Make sure 3 paragraph minimum will be fine in that email of accolades. My job during the day after 25 years as the band director, I'm a school administrator, so it's very nice to come back a few meetings a week and still return back to teaching. Our last piece is our most difficult piece, and it's the piece we've worked hardest on. It was written in 1963, called Chant and Jubilo, written by W. Francis Macbeth, and it's been a staple in the band library for a long, 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 long time. Going on, it's going to be 60 years old next year. And it's very difficult, and it's in 2 parts. The first part, as the title says, is a chant, and it's a medieval Gregorian chant that the composer has woven through with woodwinds, brass, and a little bit of percussion. Then the second half, the jubilo, is the festive part, although it's not really like super festive, like party. It's more like we're going off to war to trample the village kind of aggressiveness. Then anybody here like even remotely follow DCI, Drum and Bugle Corps, or anything like that? Okay, if you know, the people behind me do. The Blue Devils in 1975 won a championship with an arrangement of this piece, and they work very hard, but they enjoy playing it. So I want to congratulate you and thank you simultaneously for what your children are doing, and I invite you to enjoy Macbeth's Chant and Jubilo as performed by the Rowan University Concert Band. Go ahead. The last thing that I'll tell you that you need to do is I'm going to keep them seated after the last note. If you are that parent, I know I am. My son is in third grade. I'm that parent. If you would like to come up on stage and get like a cool close-up picture of your child, have at it. Just be sure to post it on your MySpace and anywhere anybody else will see it through there. All right, and here's Chant and Jubilo.
Thank you.
At this time, I'll keep with my promise. If anybody would like to carefully come up the steps, don't tell the stage manager, Dina, who's not here tonight, that I did this, but if you would like to come up and get a picture of or with your child, you may absolutely do that now. But just ask that you make it as embarrassingly as humanly parentally possible.